Are you able to see the slide? Anyone respond?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Am I audible as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Now I am going to discuss about today's revision part of Conversity Office 8. So what does it talk about? So here I won't go in detail what I had discussed during regular class. I would be a little bit faster here, and I will talk about most of practical method. Through that you can establish conversity of a set, and you might have already aware of that conversity of set is very important in order to define convex function, and later both things will help to solve the optimization problem. So today's topic is a convexity of set through practical method. So outline of my today's lectures are the following. The first practical method of the convexity of a set is that we need to recognize, we can recognize several of convex set. That one is coming from, mostly convex set those will come from either linear algebra or norm, that means topology kind of sector or analysis, and geometry. So most of convex set are coming from here, and all these kind of convex set is having a very nice geometry. So through those geometry you can easily recognize a set whether it is a convex or not. If any set which is coming from linear algebra, by default we can say that set is that set would be affine set. Even more than that, every affine set happens to be a convex set. And similarly, with respect to norm, every set associated with norm, we can, when p is greater than or equal to 1, then we will get a convex pattern. And from geometry, there are very surface, very interesting kind of quadratic surface. There easily we can identify that whether it is convex or not. So those kind of things is your first practical method. Second one is that based on definition of convexity of set, we can establish whether the given set is a convex or not. So what kind of things will come here? Here mostly we will talk about convex hull kind of things. Convex hull is what? It is based on the definition of convex combination. That means it is a collection of all the convex combination of given points or given set. So that kind of thing. So say convex hull is always a convex set. Similarly, we can define conic hull. Conic hull also it is a convex set. So this kind of, later I will call conic hull when in the category of revising dual cone, then that time conic hull we can call it simple with respect to hyperplane structure, we can give include hyper a polyhedral cone, simply we can call it like that. So conic hull is also based on that definition perspective. And apart from that, affine hull and others are also coming. I won't discuss those affine kind of things. You know that it is talking about linear combination. Okay, fine. Going forward, then I will talk about few operations that preserve convexity of a set. It is not gone through convexity of our calculus of function, that time we were discussing about those operations which preserve convexity of function. Here we will also see there are many operations which preserve convexity of a set. And because we have, why I am coming with this thing, because now we are having enough knowledge about convex function. So few things, what will happen, that few convexity of a set also we can establish from the idea of convexity of function as well. So that's way. And in if time permit, then I will talk about few problem from this separating hyperplane. Otherwise tomorrow I will discuss, in next class I will discuss. Okay, coming to first method, that simply recognizing a simple convex set, that one is coming from linear algebra and geometry and other normal structure kind of a thing. So there are many recognizable convex set that we can easily recognize. That would be hyperplane. That means it is coming from linear algebra. Subspace is also coming from linear algebra. So from linear algebra perspective, easily we can visualize. Now, after having these hyperplane or subspaces from linear algebra, further we can reconstruct other convex set based on these as well. So that's where these kind of class of convex set are very easy to recognize. And based on this, we will further define other class of convex set. So like if you are in n-dimensional Euclidean space, then if you are having a line, the line is always a, but it is a convex set. Or you can simply more say that it is having a affine structure. That means in order to define a line, what you need a point x naught and you need a direction. So a line in any n-dimensional Euclidean space, you can define like this way. So line is always happen to be a convex set. Similarly, if you observe somewhere ray is having one starting point, but final terminal point is not there. So ray is just what x naught is a very specific x naught for ray, x naught is equal to zero. A starting point we consider as zero, and we take a positive linear combination of the direction v. In that perspective, we are getting ray. So these are very simple geometric structures. So it is a line, a structural line. Both there is no starting point, no end point. Both infinitely we can walk along that line. But if you are having ray, there is a starting point. So this zero is a starting point, and you will walk in one direction. So it is zero is a starting point. So it is a ray kind of a structure. This structure is giving. So all these things happen to be convex set. Now another class of convex set, that one is coming from linear algebra. We are calling it hyperplane. So hyperplane always demand two parameter. One is the normal of the hyperplane. Another one is the bias. How? That means how much you are away from the origin in the direction of normal. So that is the concept of bias. So this hyperplane, if you are in n-dimensional Euclidean space, then hyperplane always be defined by all those points which are satisfying this equation. That means A transpose X equal to B. This one is always a definition of a hyperplane. If you are in R2, then this will define a line. If you are in R3, then this equation will define a plane, and it will go on in that process. Similarly, if you are having a hyperplane, then you can define two extra convex set. One is the upper half space. We are denoting it by all those points which are on and above the hyperplane. And here, what does it mean? So here, always the direction of normal is very important. That means we are taking the points which are in the direction of or along the direction of normal, in the side of direction of normal, not only along the direction of, in the side of direction of normal. So this one is upper half plane, and similarly we can define lower half plane or a space as well, h minus. So that is the criteria. Suppose this is your up hyperplane, it is a line in 2D. Then what is it? And this is the, always you will ask, what is the direction of normal? Second question. So suppose direction of normal is this one. So from this segment, this part you will call H plus, and the lower portion part you will call it H minus, lower upper space. So that is the criteria. Similarly, if you defining a subspace in Rn, subspace, what does it subspace? That means you are taking few vector from Rn and taking all possible linear combination those vector, those m number of vector from n dimensional Euclidean space, and in that process you are getting a structure. Like if you take only one vector from Rn and you do all possible linear combination, then what is the linear combination of a single vector? Linear combination of single vector is a same. Sorry, it is a line. If you're taking a single vector from Rn and you do linear combination, then you will get a line. But if you take two vector v1, two, remember that two non-collinear vector, one is v1, another is v2. And suppose v1 is having this position vector and this one is v2. So both you can see that v1 and v2 both are non-collinear. What does it mean, sir? That v2 is not a scalar multiple of v1. Or another way also you can say that v1 and v2 are not in the same line passing through origin. So that's why v1 and v2 are non-coplanar. So if you are taking non-coplanar, two non-coplanar vector, then what you will get? You will get a planar structure. So this is the planar structure, planar. It is a subspace in Rn. So it again defines a convex set. So it is, this one is also convex, this line is also convex. If you are taking three vectors, suppose this one vector v1 is this one, another vector this v2, and all these three vectors v1, v2 and v3 happens to be non-coplanar. That means all three are not in the same plane passing through origin. That means you can't express v3 as a linear combination of v1 rest one, rest v1 and v2. You are unable to express, you are not finding any alpha 1 and alpha 2, scalar alpha 1 and alpha 2, so that you are able to write v3 as a linear combination of v1 and v3. That means all three are linearly independent or non-coplanar. So in that perspective, you are getting a space kind of a structure. That a space structure is a subspace of Rn. So a space structure, I would like to define something like Q kind of things. And this space kind of a structure, you are getting it. So again, it is a what? It is a convex set. So all these are, so any subspace, if you take in Rn, that definitely that would be a convex set. Now, from the subspace, you can define one more structure of convex set, that we are calling it affine subspace or translated subspace. What we do, we will shift, suppose we are having a line, take in R2. Equation of line is this one passing through origin. So what would be this equation of line? Simply in notation I am writing it, it would be x transpose x equal to 0. Bias would be here 0 because it is passing through origin. Now you want to give a bias, that means and suppose direction of normal is this. This is the direction of normal. So you will proceed in the direction of normal and you will shift your this linear this line by a unit b. That means that we are calling it bias in the direction of a. In that process, what you are getting, you are getting a different line which is not passing through origin, but equation of that line is a transpose x equal to b. So this line is what? This line is called line passing through origin, this one L. Then this line would be L plus B. So you have shifted by amount B in the direction of A. That B is a bias, or you can further say that B is also in L itself. B must belongs to L plus B. That means this affine. B must be from the same affine line, the hyperplane. So this is the structure. So if, so this one is also always a convex set. So you can get it from directly shifting your linear subspace by a bias in the direction of normal, then you will get another convex set. So apart from that, there is one also important kind of convex set that we are calling it positive Rn. What does it say? It says that if you are in R2, then just take both coordinate are positive. That means where both coordinate in R2 are positive, So in the first quadrant, both coordinate are positive. Here both coordinate are positive. So this one is positive orthant in R2, and that we denote it by R2 plus. That means x1 is also greater than or equal to 0, x2 is greater than or equal to 0. If you take one extra plus, then that will talk about a strictly greater than 0. Both x1 is strictly greater than 0 or x2 is strictly greater than 0. So here single plus is talking about both x1 is non-negative and x2 is also non-negative. That means first quadrant. It is discussing about only first quadrant. So all these are very simple kind of convex set. Easily you can see from the geometry. Now, few more recognizable convex set that we can get it from a given matrix. So with respect to matrix, always we can define four special kind of subspaces. That subspaces in linear algebra we had already discussed. We are calling it fundamental subspaces of a matrix. So these are the four subspaces. This one is the row space of a matrix. This one is the null space of a matrix. And what happens? These are subspaces in domain space Rn. Suppose A is a matrix which is, it is one rectangular matrix defined from, it defines a linear transformation from Rn to Rm. Rn is your domain and Rm is your target, a target space or codomain space. So in that process, so it A brings decomposition of Rn into two parts. One subspace is this we are calling it the column of space of A transpose, and we know that column of A transpose happens to be row of A. That's why this we are calling it row space, and this one we are calling it null space. That means those elements of Rn which nullify under the operation of A. So this is null space, and this happens to be subspace of Rn, and these are again a convex set. I have taken this example for just for this better visualization of Minkowski sum. I will talk about during Minkowski sum that also preserve convexity. And the column space, that means linear, all possible linear combination of column of A, that we are calling it column space or column subspace of A. And this one is null space of A transpose. That means it is null space. Another name you can call it, it is left null space. So these two subspaces happens to be in Rn, and they do decomposition of Rn in such a way, if you take Minkowski sum of CAn, column space of An, null space of A transpose, then that would be equal to Rm. Similarly, Minkowski sum of column space of A transpose and null space of A, it will be domain space Rn. So I will give a geometry of that as well. So here geometry, you can easily observe that. So I have taken a very simple matrix, 2x2 matrix. A first column is 1, 3, second column is 2, 4. So you can find all these from linear algebra. Null space of, what is null space of this one? Null space of this matrix is a line with the direction 2, -1. And what is the column space of A transpose? That is row space of A. It would be line with direction 1, 2. We know that a line is having a unit direction. There is only one direction for a line. So it is enough to find a line in order to represent, enough to find a direction of that line in order to represent that line. So here row space and null space, both are in the codomain space. Both are in the codomain space. Both are in the domain space. Here it is a domain or Rn. Here domain and codomain space both are same. So here this one is domain. And now similarly, if you observe column space of A, this is the column space of A, which is a line with direction 1, 3, and this is the left null space or null space of A transpose. Both are in the codomain space Rn, R2. So here domain and codomain both are happens to be two dimensional space. So but here mention this one is a target space or codomain space to differentiate from general perspective, generalization of this result. for any M by N matrix. So this one is a target space. So again, you can observe that all these happens to be a convex set, because these are line n, and if you go in higher dimension, it will be a plane. So another important kind of convex set you can define with the help of a matrix, that we are calling it polyhedral in Rn. So through this matrix inequality, so you can take collection of inequality in together, and then those collection of linear inequality, it will define this inequality. So this inequality is always giving a convex structure, and that structure we are calling it polyhedral structure. So we are getting a polyhedral with respect to this system of linear inequality. If you draw system of linear inequality, then you will get a polyhedral. Polyhedral is always a convex set. So one example of polyhedral, it is given here. So you can observe that so row of A represent what? Represent normal of each hyperplane. So each hyperplane. So there are many hyperplane. So here less than equal to is taken. This one is component. It defined component wise. Component wise less than equal to. So in order to that, you are getting this polyhedral. This polyhedral is always a convex set. Similarly, positive arcend I had already discussed. And also, if you take another example which is not a convex set, if you just take consider coordinate axes in R2, and you can denote that set x1 into x2 equal to 0, it is not a convex set, because it is talking about only axes. This x1 axis and x2. That means x1 equal to 0 will talk about x2 axis, and x2 equal to 0, it will talk about x1 axis. So easily, if you take one point here and one point here, if you join these two lines, this line segment is completely out of the axis. So that's why it is not a convex set. So all these are coming from linear algebra. So one more recognizable convex set, that it will come due to norm balls. So if you define a norm ball, or simply unit norm ball, for the sake of simplicity, take radius 1. So that ball and center 0, that ball we will call it unit ball. So unit ball with respect to any P norm is always a convex set. So always you with respect to, if you observe any ball which is defined with respect to norm and it is less than equal to 1, you can always claim that it would be a convex set. But remember that if inequality is in reverse, that means if inequality is talking about greater than equal to 1 or greater than equal to some positive number, in that case it would be not a convex. So remember, if you face this kind of inequality, then it is not defining a convex set. Less than equal to it is defining a convex set. So you have to focus, you have to understand that concept. So here several P norm I have defined with respect to each of these P norm, you can define several of convex set. So any, if you define any unit ball with respect to these norm P norm, so that unit norm, it would be a norm ball, that would be a convex set. Similarly, if you here defines dual norm, what dual norm of any norm, dual norm of any norm, so it is just defining in the support kind of structure. So dual of any norm, it is talking about just support of the unit ball or unit norm ball, support of the unit norm ball in the direction of z. So this one is giving another condition of norm. If your norm is P here, you are taking two norm, that means P equal to 2. In that case, your dual norm and the P norm both would be equal. So that one is a part of different codes. We won't go in detail, just for the sake of defining several convex set with the help of norm I had discussed about. One more norm, here if you are taking P equal to 2, then what? So norm will, you can define with the help of inner product. So you can observe that square of 2 norm, it happens to be inner product of x with itself. So this P equal to 2 norm, 2 norm is very important norm, that we are calling it Euclidean norm. So So this norm you can always define with the help of inner product, but others we can't talk about. Now further we can generalize this P2 norm to any elliptical norm. So here what we do, in place of what we are taking dot product with x with x itself, so here we will define inner product by introducing the positive semi definite positive definite matrix. Even positive definite matrix is talking about invertibility of the matrix as well. So any positive definite, if you are taking positive semi definite matrix, then that matrix may not be invertible, but if you take positive definite matrix, positive definite, that means S plus plus, Sn, Sf plus plus, positive definite matrix, then this matrix is always invertible. That means P inverse always exists for positive definite matrix. And it is very interesting result. Proof is very simple. I won't go in detail. Always it exists. So you can define P norm, or you can call it norm induced by some positive definite matrix. So this norm is also, it will behave like two norm. But if you try to draw plot of this norm unit ball, then unit ball with respect to p equal to 2, it would be just a disk. If you are in R2, it would be a disk. If you are in R3, it would be a solid sphere. So that kind of a structure. But with respect to this norm induced by a positive definite matrix, it would be sometime ellipse, or depends upon what kind of matrix you are taking. So it would be, that's why this norm, you can call it elliptical norm as well. And it is very much similar to it. It is just it has been transformed from two norm. So there is a vice versa relation. You can go from two norm to this elliptical norm, and from elliptical norm to two norm as well. So whatever unit ball you will define with respect to these norm, that goes unit ball always, it would be a convex set. So these are simple structures. So that I have taken it. So this unit ball, if you take p equal to 1, so you will get this diamond shape kind of unit ball. Diamond shape, it always, it is a convex set. If you are taking p equal to 2, then you will get this disk. This disk is a complete this shaded region, inside area of as well. So this disk is a again a what? It is a convex set. And if you take p greater than equal to 2, then it is just trying to approach to a square. If you add p increase, so this one is again, what does it give? It give a convex ball, convex set. And similarly, if you take p when approaching to infinity, you will get a square. And this one is just unit ball with respect to sup norm, what you are getting, supremum norm or maximum norm. So this is the so all these what, all these unit ball happens to be convex set, a structure. Unit ball, that means less than equal to inside area, we are also including, apart from this boundary, we are also including inside area as well. So that's why you can say that all these are ball structure, solid ball structure. So all these are happen to be convex set. If these are coming from norm, those are specific norm. There is one more, that if you are having a norm ball, then what you do, by applying a invertible affine transformation, or simply b, if you take b equal to 0, that transformation you can call it a linear transformation. So here, that's why condition is, so here invertibility condition is given here. So if it is invertibility, that means a is a square, we are taking very simple kind of structure over a is a square matrix and happens to be non-singular in order to define invertibility. So if you are having a unit ball, then you apply this transformation, affine transformation over this unit ball B, and what you will get? You will get a ellipsoid. Ellipsoid, it is a unit, it is image of unit ball. And ellipsoid, you can define it like this way, through this transformation, that means T of X, such that X is coming from this unit ball. X is coming from this unit ball, means norm of X is less than equal to 1. And image of transformation, what is that? Ax plus b. And further, if you simplify it, then it will take this form. These are simple manipulation. It is not a complicated kind of a structure. So what you do, just play with this norm to a square and replace x by this transformation y. Y equal to replace x by y equal to using this one. We are having call it always we represent image by y. So that's why I am writing it y equal to a x plus b. And what you do in order to get this structure? So here write x in term of y. So what would be x in term of y? It would be a inverse of, because a is invertible, a inverse into y minus b. If you substitute this term here in this definition, that means image of this unit ball, then you will get this structure, because here ax plus b it is equal to y. So that's why we have written it y. And if you substitute here in the norm of x less than equal to 1, here substitute, then you will get this kind of quadratic form. So this quadratic form is very important. It's quadratic form. It involves a invertible matrix P inverse. And this matrix, further, if you are willing to write in term of A, what is this matrix? It is just product of A into A transpose. Then always you know that if you multiply a matrix with its transpose, whether it is pre or post multiplication, then that matrix will be always positive semi definite. But remember that A is a square matrix due to and non singular. Due to that, this matrix becomes positive definite matrix. So that's why one extra plus is coming here. Plus positive definite matrix. Okay. So what if you try to talk about from distribution of point structure? So what this one is talking about a simple symmetric Gaussian distribution. That means your point are distributed Gaussian in a symmetric Gaussian like this way around this in a circular disk fashion. That means so for this distribution is simply e to the power half. It is a very nice structure, and mean is here 0 0, x 1 square plus x 2 square. This one is the distribution for symmetric Gaussian. Now by applying this elementary row operation, your distribution has been now changed. It is again a Gaussian, but now it is having a variance. The variance is what? Variance is identity. So variance is identity matrix for symmetric Gaussian. But non-symmetric Gaussian variance would be not a identity matrix. Their variance for that, if you are applying, every point has been transformed through this transformation A, this affine transform AX plus B. Due to that, you are getting a new Gaussian transformation with which is non-symmetric. That means having a variance P. And P is what? It is defined as in term of transformation A into A transpose. It is like this way. So it is one kind of just playing with Gaussian distribution, symmetric Gaussian distribution. So a structure is already given here. So if you apply T over this unit disk, this is the unit disk, then what you will get? You will get this ellipsoid structure. And if you apply T inverse, then again from this elliptical ball, you can get your unit norm ball. So that's why it is invertible. Also, you can get suppose here transformation A is given. That's why you are getting. Suppose here your elliptical ball is given. That means you know about your covariance matrix, and your covariance matrix is P. So what will be your transformation so that you got this elliptical ball from your symmetric unit ball? So what is the transformation? If you need to know that transformation, so you're just start with proceed with your covariance matrix P. So covariance matrix P is a very nice matrix. It is positive definite matrix. That's why you can always decompose that into this eigen structure or this product of matrices. That means this one V lambda V transpose. Here, due to the property of positive definite matrix, V happens to be P or what? They are containing eigenvector of P, and this lambda is containing eigenvalue of P, and lambda is diagonal matrix, V is an orthogonal matrix. So you, what kind of a structure you do? You have converted your matrix P as a product of what? Orthogonal matrix, then a scaling matrix. Diagonal matrix is what? It is just a scaling matrix. It do a scaling along diagonal only. And V is again a rotation. So rotation, then a scaling, then again rotation. So you have converted like this way. So you further do little bit modification in order to get the transformation. What was the transformation? Through that you got elliptical ball. So this is your transformation matrix. This is the transformation matrix in term of your with respect to P. You can get because here you are having P, so you can also come across that what was the transformation that had transformed a unit ball into ellipse. So that transformation is actually V into a square root of this diagonal matrix lambda. So if you have P, you can get back your transformation. If you have transformation, you can get your Fourier matrix. So it is vice versa, both sides. So easily, that means it simply says that if you have unit ball, you can get your elliptical ball. If you have elliptical ball, you can get back your unit ball. So that is the criteria. So all those happens to be always a convex set. So whatever all. So now next is to proving concept that we will establish convexity of a special kind of set with the help of definition. That means either we will apply definition convex combination or conic combination kind of a structure. So I have taken two structure. One is conical. Suppose you are having finite number of points. So you can count x1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 points. You are having collection of 13 points. So how can we make a convex structure from these 13 points? So you do a convex combination of all the points. So once you are finished with all the convex combination, then you will get this kind of polytope. This polytope is a convex set. It is another way also you can call that this one is a convex hull. Short notation of convex hull, we denote it CONV. It is convex hull of all these points. So how many points? 13 points we are having. So it is starting from x1, x2, up to what, x3. So these are the, you are getting a new kind of convex set by convex combination. So this convex combination, we are calling it a conical. Now you are having another set. This it is a non-convex set. It is like this way. So if you observe, this one is a non-convex set, and if you do all possible linear combination, that's where that means you are just applying the definition of convex set. So in that pattern, what you do, you are getting this set. What is this set? This set is now a convex set. So through conic combination, you can always get a convex set. Similarly, if you do through convex combination, always you will get a convex set. Now, similarly, if you are having finite number of points and you are doing a conic combination, that means what is the conic combination? Conic combination for any two vector, it will say that we are taking non-negative linear combination. That means if we are having two vector V1 and V2, then we are taking all possible non-negative linear combination where alpha 1 is greater than or equal to 0 and alpha 2 is also greater than or equal to 0. In that process, whatever structure you will get, that structure would be a cone structure, a convex cone. More than that, that structure would be convex cone. So you can observe that if you are taking this point, there are many points. So what you do? So take all possible conic combination. So this is the conic combination. This conic combination is always a convex set. Similarly, if you are having set C, this set is a non-convex set. You can observe that But if you take all conic combination of points from this set called this S, then what structure you will get? You will get this cone structure. So this cone structure is again a convex shape. So that's why convex hull and conic hull both are giving convex shape. So one simple that a structure are coming as a convex hull, we are calling it polytope. If your that polyhedral happens to be bounded, then that bounded structure we will call a polytope. And in polytope also there is one special case, simplex. That means if you are in R2 and that polytope is constructed from three three points which are affinely independent. What does it mean? Affinely independent means if you consider one of the point as a reference point, then other two point would be non-collinear with respect to that reference point. So here, suppose this is x1, one point. This one is x2, and third one is x3. So you are having three point in here in the chain in R2, and you consider x1 as a reference point. Then you are getting two other two x2 and x3 by considering x1 as a reference point. X2 and x3 are non-collinear, not in the same direction passing through x1. So that's why x1 and x2 and x3 are here affinely independent. So the structure we are getting polytope, that polytope is a simplex. But suppose you are having four point, then call this point here, this is structure x1, x2, x3, x4, then four point in 2D structure can't be affinely independent. So that structure, this structure is not a simplex. It is a polytope, but it is not a simplex. Not a simplex, but a polytope. So this is the difference between polytope and simplex. If you are again coming in R3, then R3, 4, if you are taking four point in such a way, those four point happens to be affinely independent, then you will get a simplex in R3. And if you are taking four point which is not affinely independent, it would be in the five point or more than four point, then you will get a polytope structure in R3. So this structure, it is an example, it is a polytope which is not a simplex. Further, we will talk about two operations that preserve conformity of the set. So here, simplest operation is the intersection. If you are taking two convex set, C1 and C2 happens to be convex, and you are taking intersection of both, then intersection is always a convex set. Moreover, you can generalize this property to infinite intersection of convex set. That also preserves conformity. So if infinite intersection of convex set, you can denote it by this way. If C alpha, it is a collection of convex set, then intersection would be a intersection of all those collection of convex set, it would be a convex set. So many examples are there. There you can say that it generalized from take subspace, a fine set, a convex cone, all those are under arbitrary intersection happens to be a convex set. Whatever in first segment we discussed though. So one example here I have taken, if you're taking a positive semi-definite cone that we denoted by SN plus, that means it is collection of all positive semi-definite matrices. Positive semi-definite, there is a single plus, so that's why it is a collection of positive semi-definite matrices. So this the SN you can write as a intersection of all symmetric matrices which are satisfying this condition. That means this quadratic form is greater than or equal to zero. So how? In step one, what you do? Take any non-zero Z. In that process, Z transpose X. Here, what is the variable thing? That X is variable. So it is a linear function of x. X is variable, and if you are going seeing in if you are in symmetric matrix, what is the dimension of symmetric matrix? That means every entry is a variable. So what is the dimension of symmetric matrix? So I will talk about in next slide dimension of symmetric matrix for if you are taking entry from R2, it is 2x2 matrix. Then I will discuss. So this one is again it is a linear function, so it will define a half a space. So you can say that positive semi-definite cone, it is a what intersection of all half a spaces. Upper half spaces, intersection of upper half spaces. It is a convex. So due to that, the structure, the entire positive semi-definite cone is the intersection of infinite number of half spaces. That's why it is a convex set. So I have taken one practical example for S2 and S2 plus. So what is S2? If you are in S2, then always take entry. What would be? It is a symmetric matrix. So off diagonal element would be same and diagonal element would be different. So this is one example of symmetric matrix where we have taken all variables. So how many variable you observe? Just 3 variables, x, y, z. So that's way you can say that if you are taking this matrix as 2x2 symmetric matrix, what does it is talking about? It is talking about a point in R3. Euclidean space in R3. So symmetric 2x2 symmetric matrix with variable entries happens to be subspace in, or simply it happens to be in R3. So like that way. So we can plot the S2 plus as well. So I am taking it here further. What it will define. So if you are taking for any z, you are taking z transpose xz. So what does it, further it will say that it is a matrix having variable entry x, y, z, where x, what is meaning of this, say that quantity form is greater than equal to 0. It says that it means that this matrix is positive semi-definite, means principal minor. What is the principal minor of this 2x2 matrix? Principal minor would be, first principal minor would be x. And what would be second principal minor? Second principal minor would be just determinant of this matrix. What is the determinant? Determinant is xz minus y square. So being a positive semi-definite matrix, so determinant have all principal minor have to be non-negative. That means m1 must be greater than or equal to 0, or your m2 must be greater than or equal to 0. That means m1 greater than or equal to 0 implies variable x is greater than or equal to 0. M2 is greater than or equal to 0. It implies xz minus y square is greater than or equal to 0. So what is talking about? So if you just observe this one talking about if you equate 0 target surface, or simply you can say that it is a very nice kind of function. So you take equality case. So xz equal to y square. So what kind of structure you are getting here? You are getting a function which is quadratic. So you can further write this as x equal to y square equal to y square by 2. So in convex function segment, if you consider y square by 2, it is what kind of function? It is simply quadratic or linear. This function is always a convex function. So this convex function, the corresponding EP graph of the function would be what? It would be convex. If function will be convex, then if you define EP graph of x, y is quite over linear, it would be a convex. It's convex. So what is EP graph of that? It is talking about the collection of the all points which are on and above the surface. So what is meaning of on and above the surface? Meaning is this one. That means on and above means z is surface or graph is y square by x, z equal to y square. And on and above means z is greater than equal to y square by x. So that's the way we are observing here. That means if you simplify, you will get it here, same equation, this inequality. So from there, you can claim that it is a, this EP graph is a convex set. Due to that, it is a every this half space happens to be a convex structure, and intersection of all convex happens to be a convex set. This is the graph. This is the plot of what? Quadratic over linear. That means it is the plot of graph of z equal to y square by x. And the EP graph is just above on and above the graph. On and above the graph is this one. So what is that? This segment it is talking about z is greater than equal to y square by x. This region is always a, so y square over x is always a convex function. Due to that, this EP graph is always convex. So due to that, this one is defining simply a convex set, and you are talking about intersection of all those convex sets. So intersection of again all those convex sets happens to be a convex set. So that's where S2 plus is a convex set. I had already in step 2 I had already described everything. So in next class we will discuss in detail. It is already 45 minutes. So if you are having any doubt, you can ask. Otherwise, I am going to wind up today's class. Anyone is having any doubt, you can ask. In okay. Again, in next class I will discuss about few more revision from the convex set as well. And I will, in between I will solve a lot of problems as well. So how to solve, and I have written already systematic approach to solve those problems. You can go through in detail. I have already shared this full slide there in the Google Classroom. Later I will share this annotated slide as well.